Broken Pencil Magazine and CKLN are proud to present Canzine 2000, Canada's largest zine fair and festival of alternative culture, on Sunday, October 1st from 1 p.m. to 8 p.m. at the Big Box, downtown Toronto, corner of Bathurst and Queen. Over 200 underground periodicals on sale from across Canada. The zine fair runs all day. Be sure to check out the underground film and video screenings, as well as seminars on indie book publishing and making movies with Super 8 film versus digital video. Our panel of expert self-publishers and filmmakers will take you step-by-step through everything you need to know. Later in the day, listen to the panel discussion on reclaiming the media. Our panel of activists, creators, and media therapists will discuss the way media has penetrated our minds and changed the way we think and create. Come to Canzine at the Big Bop on Sunday, October 1st, starting at 1 p.m. For more information, call 927-7513 or check out Canzine on the web at www.brokenpencil.com.
Every with our lovely Celine Dion, Canada's very own. What an angelic voice, I tell you. I love Celine, you know, there's too much dislike
like
in the world.
The rod of Zeus. From the heavens.
So next up we have the one, the only Jonathan Culp, ladies and gentlemen. Jonathan Culp is a filmmaker, video maker, and he's also an activist, and he is part of the Toronto Video Activist Collective, and he, I am assuming you are also part of the Ontario Coalition Against Poverty.
I am a supporter.
You are there, and you also have been a bit of a hobo, and you've ridden the rails in your past, I believe.
I've done all that.
You know. Well, thanks for coming. Now, you are doing a little showing tomorrow called The Summer of Our Discontent, and it's an anarchist film festival. I believe.
Or of sorts.
Would you say a film festival, or would you say a screening?
It's a sort of a compact little celebration of activism in film and video. We're doing, it's a triple bill at the Anarchist Free Space in Kensington Market, looking at some of the events and issues going on in Ontario over the summer that the Video Activist Collective was fortunate enough to be in attendance to document. The first documentary we're showing of the night is Fighting to Win, which is about the events at Queen's Park on June 15th.
The most recent thing.
Yeah, when the homeless delegation came to address the legislature and met with a bit of a wall there. And
unbelievable.
One thing followed another, yeah.
Now, what do you think with that guy that runs that organization, the Ontario Coalition Against Poverty? How do you say it?
Ontario Coalition Against
Poverty.
Poverty,
right,
yeah.
The OCAP guy. Now, yeah. Remember there was a story, I don't know, I think it was in the Toronto Sun or something, that he lives in a $3 billion Cabbage Town house.
Oh, that was in our Toronto, yes, in that classy little rag. Yeah.
What is that all about? Does he really live in a $3 billion Cabbage Town
that
home?
That was a bit of a straw dog, that story, wasn't it? The whole thrust of that article seemed to be the neighbors should be really upset that John Clark is living in their neighborhood, but they're not really.
Right.
I believe he lives in a house and owns a car and all that. He's I haven't inquired into his personal life at any of the OCAP meetings, but I think the more important thing is that he recently, last week I think, regained the right to associate with the members of OCAP. He was under restraint because of his court orders, and it should be said that I was around OCAP for a good chunk of that time, and although he is a vital contributor to the coalition, life went on. There's a strong group of people there who, so all of the ideology and tactics don't originate just from one mind. It's very much a.
And what about what? Remember, I think it was last summer. I can't remember when they took over. The homeless took over Allen Gardens.
Yes, for the Safe Park. Yeah.
Right. Now, whatever happened. Now, what exactly is going on? Like, I know that these people are very, very, and I totally understand, because it's just like it's unbelievable. It's like the poor being attacked, and children are being attacked, and artists are being attacked. But so with the takeover of the I live right near Allen Garden, and, and I was there and I sort of supported them, you know, whatever. I didn't do anything. I didn't sit in with them or anything like that, but I thought good for them. But what do they want exactly? I mean, I'm sure it's many, many things, but do they just want to be heard, or do they want... money is not the answer. If you give them millions and millions of dollars, then that's just not the answer.
No. And I think that their concerns are you know, our concerns, I should say, are structural, at least in part. You know, that they're dealing with things that can't be addressed by going through the usual channels, because they're sort of built into things. And it's interesting to look at their tactics. They do handle cases, like if someone comes forward and says, you know, I'm receiving welfare, they won't give me money. They recently dealt with the case of a woman from the Somali community who had 7 children and no beds, and was trying to get money for beds, which is supposed to be welfare's
Sleep
responsibility.
Country.
Yeah,
Christine,
you know.
McGee from Sleep Country. She seems to donate
get
a lot
on
of
the
this.
Horn, yeah.
When does video come into all this? So you're documenting a lot of these. There's three of you that.
It's a revolving group. We're sort of more of a loose affiliation than sort of a tight unit that we mostly deal with issues that are close to us, covering our covering events in our own communities or, subcultures. We have done stuff on request from other groups. The Windsor thing, for instance, with the main thing of the screening tomorrow night is a premiere of a video on the Windsor protests against the Organization of American States and by extension the Free Trade Area of the Americas. Those were not issues that any of us had any particular expertise in. But we were going to the protest, and so we set up a little workstation where there were about 6 or 7 cameras, and a bunch of us were going out and collecting material, then editing it at night, and we put it up on a website,
right.
A temporary website. So
and you do all this yourselves? It's all hand done, handmade, hand.
Yeah, we use whatever technology we can get our hands on, basically.
I mean, remember there was that one. I think it was at Queen's Park. It was a couple of years ago now. I think every town sort of had an organized day where they would sort of shut down against Mike Harris,
mm-hmm.
And there seemed to be this one event. I think it was a couple of years ago. A lot of people were there that day making films about that. What were they called? Action Days?
The Metro Days of Action.
Metro Days of Action.
Yeah, actually, one of the first video activist things I did. I was at that protest with my Super 8 camera, but looking around, I saw that almost everyone in there. Aunt Agnes had a video camera there, so I put a notice in Now magazine saying, "Give me your footage. I'd like to edit something out of it." And through that, I found out that, Cara Morton was making a film. Stuart Andrews and Scott McLaren and Kika Thorne made a film on that day.
I think Roberto Agronello, Marcos. All these tons of independent filmmakers in our community were there.
Yeah, so I put a tape together. Tried to condense all that stuff into one.
And you did do a screening of that. The Days of Action. You did do a screening.
Yeah, we screened that at Symptom Hall back.
Right.
When
the good old days of Symptom Hall. What are the reactions to all the? Do the people when they see these videos and they see these films, do they think you guys are just a bunch of hippies and get jobs, or are they out there supporting you? Or are they out there saying, good for you, at least you're exposing something, and so we can all see, and you're packaging it together it's all there.
The role and the targets of video activism, hasn't completely developed in terms of its aesthetic or its outreach potential. Often we are in sympathetic groups.
Mm-hmm.
The viewing is more hindsight, looking at tactics, drawing links to other events and other movements that are going on. Like, I'm sure the Windsor video will be useful for the people leading up to the anti-FTAA protests in Quebec City, which are being planned in April, which are an extension of what happened in Windsor.
Right.
A continuation of that.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
But we try to make them watchable and entertaining. There's a resistance, a logical resistance, I think, to people who come into an art form seeking to educate the masses with it. When you get Stalinists trying to rewrite T for Two as a statement on
Well, there's a little line here. It says, presented with... This is a little line from the 38 short films about the OAS, and it says, presented with all the humor, excitement, and yet, you bet, violence of a Hollywood spectacle.
That's right. Violence is an important part. Yeah. A lot of these videos tend to follow the same plot line, and as a result, we've added the Buster Keaton short "Cops" to round out the triple bill, as sort of a thematic statement of the evening.
Now, I remember this thing in Windsor happened, and all those people in Windsor thought it was going to be, it's going to be beautiful, and it's going to really showcase Windsor, and it's going to be this and that. But then people went there. It ended up being like a police state.
There were, I think, 5,000 police in Windsor.
And so anybody that went there think, maybe it'll be tourism dollars or something like that. People going to Windsor, for example, for the very first time, thinking, oh my God, this is like a police state. What am I in?
Yeah, and that's part of the tactics too, is that fewer and fewer cities are willing to host these things because it ends up costing them a lot more money than it brings in. And one way to stop these things from happening is to make them more trouble than they're worth.
Oh well, it just makes the city. I mean, it's true. The cities are just don't want to do it because it's just brings bad PR, and it's the world is focused on their city or whatever for a day or two, and all they see is riots.
Well, in Windsor, which was a completely nonviolent, tactically nonviolent protest, they had cops in Darth Vader uniforms with their shields out, marching through the barricades to pepper spray people in the face when they're sitting down.
Wow!
And so
it's just they were afraid of Seattle, obviously, repeat performance of what happened
in
Seattle.
Oh, they were afraid of it. You can go on about how that was, that followed on to excessive police force as well. That, you know, that turns into the root of the problem if you look at it.
And then now we're into the bathhouse raids of the Pussy Palace recently. So it's
absolutely
unbelievable. Now you this little collective that you I shouldn't say little this collective that you belong to. So it's basically you don't provide cameras for anybody. It's just do it yourself and do what you can.
Yeah, we don't have that many technical resources, although we'd like to. We're getting some interest and support from labor groups as we do more work, and we're hoping that we can translate that into some more permanent resources and things that we can give to the community to help them. But what we're trying to do is to get people to make their own videos, make their own statements, and facilitate that. We've done training through the Free University of Toronto,
right?
And we'll in a pinch we'll come down and tape things for people. But we training is our priority. And you know, in a situation like the Pussy Palace raids or whatever, where it would be probably beneficial to have working on art about that stuff.
Give those lesbians a voice, I say. Mm-hmm. And now, how do we get in contact with you for the Summer of Our Discontent, the insurgent video from Ontario and beyond? It's this Saturday, September the 23rd?
September the 23rd, yep. It's at 6 p.m. at the Anarchist Free Space, which is 254 Augusta Avenue in Kensington Market. it's part of a weekly series that OCAP puts on there. Actually, every Saturday at 6 they have videos, so this is just a special presentation. It's pay what you can, or free if you buy a video. We'll be selling videos there as well. And if you want more information, you can call me, Jonathan Culp, at 536-6092.
And the website or the email is how do you say this?
Yes, my own email is one of them is Luganbin. That's my old band at yahoo.com. That's LOOGANBIN. And
at yahoo.com.
At yahoo.com.
That's right. You're a musician. I totally forgot about your musical. Yeah.
That's a residue from the Luganbin days. My new band is called the Chewies, but Chewies at Yahoo isn't up yet.
The Chewies.
Yeah,
they're very good.
This email information is also good for people who are interested in showing their own independently produced films and videos at Canzine, which is happening on Sunday, October 1st. And I'm helping them put a video screening together for that as well. So anyone who's making stuff, come on down and we'll show it if it's 15 minutes or less.
And so this is Canzine's coming up, and it's you've got a call for submissions here. But have you already got your programming, or are you still looking for?
We tried imposing a submissions deadline so we could curate something. We've got several people bringing in stuff, but there will probably still be room to program things spontaneously if you just want to drop by the Big Bop a week Sunday. There'll be a venue from 3 to 6 p.m.
I don't think it's called the Big Bop anymore.
No, but that's now?
It's
like...
It's called the Cathedral, I think it is. The old-timers like me remember it. I went to the opening of the Big Bop, like when it opened, the opening night, as a young child.
I think it's just the name of the... It's like the landmark.
Yeah,
Etobicoke isn't Etobicoke anymore.
Yeah, right.
But still talk about it that way.
And of course, most of these things, it says also here, no stupid bullshit, please, i.e. racism, sexism,
etc. That should go without saying, but you never know on this level.
And Canzine, of course, is a festival of some sort, and it's like independent... independently produced magazines. Some of them are hilariously funny, and it's Canzine's been around for a while now.
It's been around for a few years. Yes, it's put on by Broken Pencil magazine.
Broken Pencil,
and
yes.
They've I guess become interested in focusing a little more regularly on video and film. So as of this issue, which is coming out at Canzine, I am editing a reviews section for them of low to no budget film and video, sort of the in the same vein as the publications that they review.
Right.
So hoping to find ways to get more exposure for people who are doing things really underground, really independent.
Right. And will there be a screening of any of this? any of this work? Because, you know, some of it's... Well, you got some great people on this. It's like Andrew B., Laura Cowell, Jim Monroe. There's some really great people involved.
Yeah, there will be seminars and panels and discussions as well. There will be a do-it-yourself film and video panel, how to publish your own book, which Jim Monroe did earlier this year.
Publish your own book. You just get a photocopier. Some of those things are most... I think some of those posters that you see on the streets, like just some of the things, are the most hilarious, beautiful pieces of art I've ever seen in my entire life.
Oh, sure. Yeah, yeah.
They are so beautiful. Now, Jonathan, let me ask you this. Why does every Canadian thing have to have a panel discussion? Why? Why are we have to have... It's like, okay, let's talk about it. We'll have a panel discussion.
Yeah, yeah. There's, we need experts to tell us different things, right? Of course, at the Anarchist Free Space, we can't get away with that. So yeah. We're just having a free-for-all, raise your hand and let her rip.
All right, now, so, okay, let's go over everything again, and then you can add anything you want as a final complaint or a final piece of information. You know, what's bothering you right now, Jonathan?
Oh, my goodness. What's bothering
me? Just bitch about something.
Let's see.
There's got to be something.
Well, the Olympics. The Olympics are going on. I could talk about...
You don't like the Olympics?
Well, actually, I've been fretting about the Olympics coming to Toronto.
Right.
As have many. It's like, you know, if we can't afford low-income housing, we shouldn't be building a monorail to the airport.
Yeah,
you know, that kind of thing.
I'm mad about the men swimming because they're wearing those full-length suits now, and I just like it when they wear those little tiny pieces of handkerchiefs. But now they're wearing like full. That's my circle.
Well, I must say, Peter Mansbridge's little thing about that African guy swimming the 100 meters who had never swam 100 meters before.
Oh yeah, 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 yeah.
And they were going bats over that on the national, and it was like, give it a rest. It was a little bit
because the guy that did it, like, he's never even swam in a 50-meter pool before, and he won because everybody was disqualified because everybody else had a false start, so he actually won his heat.
Uh-huh.
You know, his whatever, you know, his heat, they're called.
Yeah, yeah, but, and there was a lot of, silly little man.
I thought that was great, though. What the hell, but yeah. I just don't like them wearing those full-piece bathing suits, those males. I'm a little upset. But so if they do get the Toronto one, I don't want them to wear that. And also, yes, we can't afford low-income housing. We don't need a...
throwing our bodies on the gears for those small bathing suits.
And what else are you mad about? You're mad about the Olympics? What else are you upset about? What else is bugging you?
I'm mad. I'm mad that I can't find a second guitarist for my band.
Damn it. Well, if you know anybody, go to the Summer of Our Discontent, talk to Jonathan Culp. I'm assuming you're going to be introducing these films.
I'll be around.
You'll be around. And if you are a guitar player, you know, Jonathan is looking for a guitar player, and also they want an audience. How many people come to these screenings? They're a weekly event.
They're a weekly event. The weekly ones are sort of low key. But the last time our circle helped out with an event at the Free Space was the Go Gorilla screening. Some people from Buffalo came up and they showed a film about political cream pies, throwing cream pies at Bill Gates and CEOs of Chevron and stuff. And we had over 100 people crammed in there.
Oh, that's good. Well, what's his name? Chan just got one recently.
Following a great tradition.
Right. Okay, Jonathan, well, give us a final plug about your CanZine information and also the Summer of Our Discontent. And it's lovely to see you again. I haven't seen you for a while.
Yeah, so. Likewise, Keith. Good
you're just saying that.
Oh, no. The good old days. I haven't forgotten.
But before we go, we can let Tim pick any piece of music that he wants to pick, because he's had to listen to Celine Dion and Donna Summer.
So the activist thing is tomorrow night at 6 p.m. at the Anarchist Free Space. CanZine is Sunday, October 1st. The screening is 3 p.m. to 6 p.m., and that's at the former Big Bop.
Thank you very much, and this has been Frameline. Barbara will probably be back next week, so enjoy me while you can. Thanks a lot, Jonathan, for coming on today.
Thank you, Keith.
Thank you very much, Tim, for teching the show.
Ever since I just let you in.